Hello everyone and welcome to a new video. Today's video is going to be a pretty casual project log, and it might not be a particularly in-depth project log because I'm mostly making this costume for personal reasons and I've been filming a lot recently and I kind of want to break from it, but it also seems like a really good opportunity to film. So I might not film every step for constructing this costume, but hopefully I will include little clips here and there and get a video's worth of footage out of it. I'm really, really excited to be working on this since I haven't made very many truly historical costumes this year, and I really, really miss it. It's definitely where my heart and where my passion still is. So as much as I've enjoyed making some more modern pieces and focusing on some simpler designs, I miss the full-length frilly dresses. I'm really, really hoping to kind of remedy my lack of historical costume construction in my life over the next couple of days. So let's go ahead and get started.
So my ideas are for an 1830s dress, kind of a late 1830s dress, as well as a late 1840s dress. And I was just going to make one of these, but I can't decide which design I like better, and they would be worn with the same foundations. So I think it kind of makes sense to draft them both at the same time, and then I can fit them both at the same time, and maybe from there I can decide which one I'm more enthusiastic about, or I can decide to make both of them, which is kind of what I'm leaning towards at the moment. One of these dresses is based off of an example from the Metropolitan Museum of Art. I feel like it's kind of boring to really closely follow an extant example, but that's what I feel like doing right now, so I think that's what I'm going to go with. And maybe when my head is a little bit clearer and I don't have as many other projects distracting me, I can feel a little bit more inspired to design my own things. But right now I really want to make this dress, and I also really, really want to make this dress, which is something I saw posted on Instagram a while back and just fell in love with. It's the seaweed print fabric, and it's in the style of an 1830s dress, and it reminds me a lot of a floral dress that I made when I was first getting into historical costumes. So I like this dress on its own, and I also like the idea of making it and then comparing how much my skills have improved in the past couple of years. So I thought this would be a really fun project, and I bought fabric for it a couple months ago, but I just haven't had time to work on it. So I'm hoping that this week is the week for this dress to come into existence. So I don't know how much you'll be able to tell, but it has this really cool gathered neckline detail, then the front overlaps and has a waistband and then banded sleeves. And I'm gonna go ahead and drape these patterns. I haven't decided what dress form to drape them on. I got a new dress form recently. It looks like this, and it is a PGM dress form, and I don't love it as much as I thought I would love it. I feel like the chest is really, really high, so when I fit stuff over the bust, it doesn't necessarily fit me that well, and I'm not sure how to pad it, so that is better. But I do like that it has a very nice booty. It definitely resembles the female form a lot more accurately than the display form that I've been using for years prior. So I do like it, but I'm less confident when I drape on it since I'm so used to draping on the other one. So I'm not sure if today is a good day to risk draping on this one or if I should just stick to my comfort zone. I ended up draping both of the patterns, and then I got them transferred to paper, and I turned those paper patterns into mock-ups. So this is the mock-up for the 1830s dress with the gathered neckline. This was pretty successful, but there were some issues with the shoulder placement and the gathering at that point. So I did have to make some alterations there. I also had to lengthen the waistline and take it in at the sides, and I'm going to have to add lining to the back to help support the gathers because this was making the waist appear much bigger than it actually is. So there were definitely some alterations needed, but for the most part, it was successful. This mock-up turned out pretty well too. I did all of the gathering at the front by machine, and that was really effective. For the real thing, though, I'm definitely going to do it by hand. The waist of this actually fit really nicely, but I did have some issues at the chest. So this dipped way too low, so I had to add an extra piece here. And then I found that I also had to taper this portion in a little bit since it wasn't particularly fitted to the chest. I'm also letting the arm side out quite a bit. Since this is supposed to be sort of off the shoulder, this needs to come out by almost an inch more. So there are definitely some pretty major alterations to be made here, but I'm happy with how it came along. I just realized I forgot to add one alteration to the back, though. I was supposed to taper that in by a quarter inch, so I need to do that. But then I can go ahead and get started on the real thing, which I'm super excited about because this involves a bunch of yummy hand sewing, which I haven't done in quite a while. And all of the seams are going to be finished with piping. It's a really annoying but kind of satisfying detail to do. So I'm really looking forward to these projects, and I'm so excited to get started on them today. I think my first action is actually going to be doing the gathering for both of them. And this is partially motivated by the fact that I have a new episode of RuPaul's Drag Race from last night that I would really like to watch. And I can do all of that gathering goodness downstairs while I watch it. So I'm going to get the bodices cut out and then I will decide what to do next. Oh, but I should show you which fabrics I purchased for this project, shouldn't I? For the 1930s dress, based off of the gown that was made from a seaweed print floral fabric, I purchased this really wonderful mustard-based Moda floral print. I think it's just beautiful. I used, I think, a different purpley-toned material from this collection for an 18th century dress, and it was such a joy to work with, and I love the weight of it and the prints so much that I decided to order another one. And if this is still available, then I can leave a link to it down below. It's got blue flowers and red flowers and little stalks of wheat, and I don't know, I just think it's beautiful. And then for the 1840s dress, I have this Washington Street Studio quilting fabric, which I purchased when I was in Pennsylvania. I don't think it's by Moda, it's by a more inexpensive brand, but the quality still feels really nice. I think this fabric was $8 or $9 a yard, whereas this one was probably $5 or $6. It's funny, this fabric totally makes me think of like fast food almost, because it's got the ketchup color as a base and then it's got little relish colored and mustard colored dots on it. But I do really like it and I think it's a super fun print and very appropriate for summer. I was actually originally going to make this dress out of a plaid fabric. You can kind of see it down here on my very messy floor. I feel like this is a better fabric for summer, and though I'm tempted to save it for a more elaborate cotton 1860s dress, I'm going to be going back to Pennsylvania relatively soon, and I don't think I'm going to make two dresses like this in a similar time frame. So I can always get more, or I can get more of something similar and use this up in the meantime. So that's where I'm at now, and I'm going to get to cutting things out, and then I shall report. So I went ahead and made the piping for this, since pretty much every seam is piped, and I used a very tiny construction cord for it and bias cut 1-inch wide strips of the quilting cotton. And that went surprisingly well. In the past, I've really struggled to make really tiny piping. I don't know if I was using too thick a fabric or I just wasn't taking enough time to do it, but I always ended up sewing over the piping cord because it was so thin. But that didn't happen this time, and I think it looks really good. So I went ahead and sewed it onto the curved back edge, and now I have to iron this slightly because it puckered a bit. And I'm going to top stitch the other panel over top to hide this raw edge. And to make that a little bit easier, I've gone ahead and used stitching to mark a line 1/2 inch away from the edge. And then I'm going to go over to my iron and just fold it inward at that stitch line. And not only does this give me an easy line to follow when folding the edge inward, it will also prevent the fabric from fraying as much at that edge. So it's just a win-win all around. So I went ahead and folded the edges inward and then I pinned them together. And now I'm just going to top stitch across this fold as opposed to sewing it as a normal seam. And I haven't quite decided how I'm going to finish the interior just yet, or if I'm going to finish the interior. A lot of garments weren't actually finished on the inside at this point in time. There are just so many layers between you and the actual garment, and garments were washed less frequently, so edges were just less prone to fraying. So I might just go ahead and whip stitch the raw edges together and leave it at that, but I haven't decided yet. I am kind of tempted to make it pretty inside. We'll just have to wait and see. So I'm going to stitch this down and then I will be back. So I finished sewing the pieces for the back together and then I gave it an iron, and I've decided that I am going to line it because I looked up some photos of the interiors of bodices from the 1830s and 40s, and they're actually lined really nicely, at least most of them. But I'm not going to line it until I have the front panel on, because then the lining will cover the seams there as well. Does that make sense? Hopefully it does. So what I've gone ahead and done is marked the gathering points onto the front panels, and now I'm going to gather this down by hand. I'm also going to gather down the top edge. And I have a little guide for while I'm downstairs, so I know what to gather everything down to. The top gets gathered down to 11 inches, this band gets gathered down to 7 inches, 6.5 inches, and 6 inches, a half inch away from the bottom edge. And I'm also going to try and gather down this beauty, which will make up the neckline for the 1830s project. And I haven't finalized the gathering measurements for this just yet, but I do have a good idea of what they're going to be, so I'm just going to gather it down to approximate measurements, and then I can fiddle around with it a little bit more later on. So the top edge will be 19 inches and the bottom edge will be 24 inches. And unfortunately, I had to put a seam in this piece at the center front. I wanted it to be all one continuous piece, but to get the grain line to look nice, I had to cut it as two pieces. So it is what it is, and it should be densely gathered enough that it isn't super obvious. So I went ahead and gathered the front panel down down, and then I sewed up the side seams, and I got those ironed, and I also sewed some boning channels into the seam just to help support the bust in that area. That might end up backfiring on me because I didn't do that with my mock-up, but it feels like a good idea, so we'll see how it goes. And then this is what it looks like from the front. I'm a little bit annoyed with how the pattern matches here, but this was cut all as one piece. I need it to be straight in the front, so it just kind of is what it is. But I'm really happy with how the gathering looks so far, and I hope it comes together and fits nicely once I get the collar on, or the yoke, I guess it would be referred to. But before doing that, I have to line this because it doesn't look super pretty inside. So I've already cut out a really lightweight cotton to line this with, and I'm just going to top stitch that into position. I'm going to line the yoke separately, which will finish that edge, and then these will just be bias bound, so I don't have a whole lot of fancy work to do. Hopefully that won't take me very long. So I just procrastinated for like 2 hours because I messed something up and was annoyed about it. I actually don't know when I last updated you on what this looks like, but I ended up sewing the collar on, and I finished the arm openings with piping and folded that inward and whip stitched it to the lining, and then I went ahead and sewed piping onto the shoulder seam. So I was just about to fold this edge inward and top stitch it onto the other end of the strap, and I decided to pin it and do a fitting first, and I could not get my arm through the arm side, which is not a particularly good sign. So I realized I need to add a patch to make it bigger. So the first patch I made looked like these, and they did not fit particularly well. As you can see, it lined up well with this front piece, but didn't line up very well with the back, and it just looked awkward and bulky. I tried dragging it over closer to the edge, and that looked bad, and finally I decided to take those off and to redo it and to properly slope the side so it would line with the arm side. Honestly, this would not have been a big deal to do at all, except I notched the edge of the arm side after sewing on piping so I could turn it inward. So I couldn't just remove that piping because the fabric there was no longer structurally sound enough for me to sew on new piping. If I had been able to just sew in this patch and then redo the arm side and have the piping be continuous, it would have been super easy. But since I couldn't do that, I had to add the piping to all of the edges of the little addition. It was just a real pain, and doing it twice was a real pain. But it's now done, at least on one side. The other one is over here. So I'm going to go ahead and sew that on, and then I can finally begin moving forward again. I'm not sure what I'm going to do next. You shall just have to wait and see. So I'm happy to report that I draped the sleeve, and this went surprisingly well, so I hope it looks good when I actually get it finished. But the sleeve consists of a shoulder portion. I can actually show you a picture of the garment I'm basing this off of. So I don't know if you can see, but there's kind of like a strap that forms it off the shoulder. So I went ahead and drafted that. And I think it looks pretty good and pretty similar, though I'm not trying to make it perfectly similar. And then I also drafted a undersleeve portion, which is going to support the second ruffle here. So these are the two main sleeve components, but then there are also going to be 2 3-inch wide strips. Actually, the finished length is 3 inches wide, so they will probably be 4 inches wide with a 1/2-inch allowance at either end. And those will make up the ruffles. And I haven't decided how long I'm gonna make them yet. I will probably make them twice or three times the width of this piece. So that's, I don't know, probably 30 inches. I haven't decided yet. I'm gonna do that next. But first I want to get these pieces cut out. I also went ahead and drafted the facing, and I just drafted this based off of the pattern that I made earlier. I traced the neckline, but I did add an additional 1.5 inches where the pieces joined to account for the addition I had to make to the shoulder. So now I'm going to get this cut out of the lining fabric, this cut out of the top fabric in addition to the ruffles, and then I will have a whole bunch of hand sewing to keep me busy tonight while I watch Naked and Afraid or something that I probably shouldn't waste my time watching, but I do because I am one of those people. So far today, I definitely procrastinated more than I should have, but I'm pretty happy with how things have gone. Usually sleeves are kind of my nemesis with these projects, and they really force me to hold them off, so I'm happy that I have that part kind of covered, or at least the early stages of it covered. I also want to say that I'm pretty proud of myself for working through that shoulder issue today, though that is not a huge deal. Once I reach a roadblock with something, even if it's small, like that only took me 1.5 hours to fix or something, which is longer than it probably should have. But once I actually sat down and worked on it and tried to find the solution, it was not a difficult fix. But things like that can make me really discouraged sometimes. And once I'm discouraged about a project, I don't want to work on it. And it's hard for me to go back to it. But at the same time, it's hard for me to continue working on something when I'm frustrated. I don't feel like that's the best mindset to be sewing and to be problem solving.
But at the same time, if I leave that problem, it's unlikely it will ever get resolved. So I'm glad that I worked through it today and I can continue with motivation for this project and hopefully get it finished up tomorrow. Watch the sleeves turn out horribly and me dropping this project completely after that happens, but hopefully we won't run into that.
So it is the next day and I'm hoping to get this dress finished up. Last night I went ahead and hemmed the 4 strips, which make up the ruffles for the sleeves. I also added piping to the bottom edge of the top portion of the sleeves, as well as finished the top edge. And then this is the lower portion of the sleeve. So they stack on top of each other and that creates the tiered ruffle effect and supports everything. And I did this all by hand, both the hem as well as the gathering, since I wanted it to look very pretty and precise. But I did sew it on by machine since that stitching is going to be hidden. Then I went over to the bodice and started lining it. So the first thing I did regarding lining was sewing bias binding across the piping work that I did on the arm side, since that was fraying pretty badly and it won't be covered when I attach the sleeves. And then I went ahead and pinned in the facing. And if you have a dress form that is similar in size to the garment that you are making, the best way to line it is by putting it on the dress form inside out and then draping the lining over top of it. Obviously you want to double check and make sure nothing is puckering from the right side, but it is so much easier than trying to get bodices lined when you have them laid flat. Things like the shoulders can be especially difficult to get lined nicely, and this just makes the whole process really easy. So now I'm going to take this off the dress form and slip stitch into position, and then I can get the sleeve sewn up and get those sewn on, and we'll be one step closer to finishing this piece. So I haven't been the best about filming or the best about sewing today, but what I want to update you on is the skirt for this. So I've gone ahead and cut out these skirt panels, and I had a ton of this fabric, so I decided to make the skirt 4 panels wide when I would usually just do 3 panels. So it'll have a total width of 42 times 4, 168 divided by 36, so I guess like 4.5 yards, which should be enough to give me a lovely full skirt, though I am slightly concerned about how much bulk there is at the waistline, or how much bulk there will be at the waistline, so we'll just have to see how this goes. But I went ahead and slashed the top of the back panel open to create a slit, which is going to be how I get this dress on and off. I'm going to hand sew this on later tonight, and for now I'm going to go ahead and French seam all the panels together. I'm going to do 1/4 inch wide French seams just so it won't fray, and those will look nice and tidy. I'm also going to cut off the entirety of the selvage on both sides of the fabric, since this is one of those materials where the selvage pulls slightly on the fabric and can make it look a little bit puckered at the edges. I definitely don't want that included in my seams. And in case you're wondering, all the panels are cut to be 50 inches long. I'm planning on doing a 3.5 inch hem, and there's a 1/2 inch allowance at the top edge. So that is my like crappy math. And I just tore the fabric or notched it and then tore the fabric every 50 inches to create 4 even panels. So now these are going to get sewn together, and hopefully I can get this hem tonight while watching some TV or something. My dress form isn't really doing this any favors right now, but I also got these sleeves assembled, then I got them sewn on. I don't know when I updated you about the sleeves, but I ended up sewing them together with a normal 1/2 inch allowance, and then I whip stitched the allowance down. So it doesn't look super pretty on the inside, but it shouldn't be that prone to fraying either. And I actually left this top edge raw as well, since I didn't want a lace or binding to be visible from the front when it's worn. So that's kind of unfortunate, but it's not a major big deal, and it's not going to fray that much when I'm wearing it. So though this isn't the best image of what the bodice is going to look like, I'm really happy with it so far, and I've pinned the back edge, which is the only unfinished edge aside from the bottom on this thing, and hopefully I can get that whip stitched into position tonight as well and prepped for hooks and eyes. I do have some markings for the hooks on this as well. So that's where I currently am, and I will probably update you later tonight or tomorrow depending on how things go. Alright, so I have some updates for you guys. I made some progress on the bodice, sewed hooks and eyes into the back of it, and I used size 2, which are larger than I usually use, but I was looking at extant garments and they actually had pretty substantial hooks on them. I think so potentially a woman could do them up herself. So I used larger ones than I normally would have, and now the bodice portion of this is pretty much done. I just have to add a band around the waistline, which will cover up this as well as the bottom 2 inches of the bodice, but I can't add that until I have the skirt sewn on. And the skirt is over here, and I've made some progress on this as well. I seamed all of the pieces together with 1/4 inch French seams, and then I turned the hem inward by 1/2 inch, and then I turned it inward by 3 inches, and used a cross stitch to stitch it down. And I do have a tutorial on this stitch on my channel if you're interested. And then for the top edge, I went ahead and gathered this down to 28, 29, 30 inches, something like that, whatever the bottom measurement of the bodice is. Now I'm going to sew this onto the bodice, and I haven't decided quite how I want to do that just yet, but I'm going to figure it out and do that, and then I will update
you. So I'm happy to report that this dress is done. It took me until 11 p.m., but I did manage to get finished today, which was my goal. And my camera's not going to focus on that. So what I did was I folded the bottom edge of the bodice outward, and then I basted it down, and you can still see my basting stitches. And then I top stitched the skirt over top of that, so the raw edge was facing outward. And as you can see, this isn't super even. That's because I wanted the skirt to be slightly higher at the front, so it'd be more of a walking length at the front, and then drag on the sides a little bit more. Also from the side, you can see the hooks that I sewed in. I tried to do a really good job. I usually get super sloppy because I hate sewing them on, but I tried to keep mine relatively clean this time, and I think it did a decent job. Once the skirt was sewn on, I stitched I don't really want to call it a waistband, but it certainly looks like a waistband over top, and this covers that panel at the front that I showed you earlier, and also makes it more similar to the piece this was based on. So it doesn't fit my dress form as well as it fits me, and I also don't have a petticoat on it, but you can get an idea of the shape of it. I really love how the bodice of this turned out. There were a couple things I might do differently if I remade something like this in the future, but I think it's such a cute, interesting design, and it's very simple looking. But it also has a lot of detail to it with the ruffles and the piping and the gathers and the shearing, and I'm just really pleased with how this came together. Oh, the back looks terrible because it doesn't fully fit my dress form, so we'll just turn it back around, but trust me, it fits me just fine, which is what's important. But what I want to say is that I really enjoyed this project. I've been kind of stressed recently, and I've been focusing a lot on the Sewing Through the Decades project and building my own wardrobe and filming those videos, which is a lot of fun, but it's not my true passion, the way historical gowns are. And the historical pieces I have been working on have been paid work for McCall's, which is just like a dream come true, and I love being able to do that so much. But there's a certain level of stress knowing that people are going to be looking over my work on those pieces very closely, and also trying to alter them and make them accessible to a larger group of people, and maybe not following my original vision 100% for the pieces. So that work, though it's enjoyable, it has a lot of layers over top of it that make it a little bit more stressful. Whereas this was just pure fun, going with the flow, working at my own pace, working hard on the construction, but not feeling pressured to make it perfect. And I just enjoyed this project so, so much. It was like the best way I could have spent my weekend. So I really loved making this dress. I really love the finished dress. I'm probably not going to be able to include worn photos of it in this video. People always get mad when I say that, but I have to edit these videos in advance just to get the amount of space that the raw files take up off my computer as quickly as possible, and also for monetization purposes so I can get it up on YouTube and have it go through their filtering process before publishing it and potentially losing out on ad revenue. But there's going to be a part two to this video where I finish up the floral dress, which didn't get as much focus in this video. And there's also going to be a blog post to go along with these videos. So definitely check out the description box down below, and I will have worn photos linked down there. And if you enjoyed this video, then you can give it a like and a comment. Those really help me out. You can also subscribe to this channel if you would like to see more of my videos and see the part two of making this dress's sister, along with all sorts of other content. And if you'd like to see me make more things and get access to exclusive videos and additional content, then check out my Patreon. It'll be linked down below as well. So that is where this video is going to end. Thank you for coming on this journey with me. I hope you enjoyed it, and I will talk to all of you very soon.